Hello, Celeste here from Hexen Arcane, and it's a wonderful day. I'm so excited about some stuff I got going on, but anyway, I won't get to that yet, because first, I wanted to intro the movie that we're showing tonight, and this movie is the 1968 Kong Island, which doesn't actually have anything to do with King Kong, but there's gorilla suits, and I had to cut out some parts of the movie that we couldn't show on TV, so probably not worth searching out, but you know, you're welcome to if you want to see the uncensored version that we can't show. Anyway, I'm super excited because there's a lot of adventures. I went to a pumpkin patch, so when it was still warm enough to do so. And also took a trip to Maquoneago, Wisconsin, where I found a bunch of interesting stuff that I wasn't expecting. So, during this film, you can look forward to those adventures. And, even more exciting, yes, I'm really excited about this. Morgan! I don't think she can hear me from this distance, but I'm sure everyone will appreciate these jokes. Why did King Kong join the army?
Oh my god, shut up!
To learn about guerrilla warfare! Alright, I got another one. Okay, what do you do if King Kong sits in front of you at the cinema?
Shut like up! That one.
What do you do? You miss most of the film! I kill myself. Alright, one more. I have to tell this one. So, what happened when King Kong swallowed Big Ben? I'll wait.
Shut up!
He found it time-consuming!
Oh my god.
That's a good one! Stop. It's funny! Okay, well, I don't care if no one else likes my jokes. I'm having fun with them, and I hope you guys really enjoy this movie and all the crazy adventures.
Necessary. Afraid of the dead, Bert? The payroll money should help you ease your conscience. It must be over $300,000, as you know.
This means we won't ever have to work for a living anymore.
You won't, anyway. You were crazy!
Thank you.
Ready? Yes.
Yes, Mr. Theodore.
Sight for sore eyes.
Hello, Theodore.
How about having a little drink in honor of the returning prodigal?
Sure. You know, this is really a big surprise. I heard about that little accident of yours, and I thought you left Africa for good.
No, Africa won't let me off the hook. There's no work for us mercenaries right now. So I thought I'd come to Nairobi for the sake of old times and old friends. So what's it doing?
Nothing much.
By the way, have you seen Albert?
No.
Which one was Albert? Oh, yes, I think I remember your mad doctor friend. I haven't seen him for a good many years.
Oh? Actually, that's what I was just going to ask you. He was your medico, wasn't he? I thought you boys left Nairobi together.
Yeah, but a while ago, we split up.
Is there anything wrong?
I hope I can locate him. I want to see him about this.
So you're back to your old game, eh?
Well, answer me.
Oh, don't be so stupid.
You think I'm stupid, do you? I want to know what Bert's doing here.
You heard, didn't you? He wants Albert.
Or he wants to be with you. Seems you're still in love with him, aren't you?
Forget that. There's been nothing between us for years. Bert is no more than a memory.
Be careful, Ursula. I'm warning you. If you're lying, you'll regret it.
Just remember this. He's the one you have to worry about. And he's really not the type of man who gives up easily.
No, the other one was too heavy for me. After a few shots, my arm feels like it's broken. I'd rather take this one, even if it isn't as powerful. The last time I used it, I never missed. And I wasn't tired at all. After all, the most important... Look who's here, Bert!
Hi, Diana.
Oh, what a surprise! You haven't changed a bit. You're as handsome as ever.
And you're looking lovely.
Take your hands off that girl, or you're a dead man.
Robert, how's everything?
Great, how are you?
Better keep an eye on your sister, buddy. She's no little girl anymore.
Oh, stop teasing me. I can look after myself. Tomorrow I'm hunting big game.
What animal are you hunting?
Sacred monkeys.
Oh? I never heard of them. What are they?
It's an old native legend. There's supposed to be some kind of sacred wild monkey somewhere out there.
It stays in the forbidden part of the jungle. Forbidden to white men. But you will take me, Robert. I mean, you promised to let me come along. As long as Dad doesn't find out where we're going. He made me swear never to go near that part of the jungle.
Is that the way you keep your word?
I had my fingers crossed.
Bert. Why don't you come with us? It'll be a hell of a lot of fun.
No, thanks. Firearms make me sick.
You've changed, like everything else, including Dad's place.
You mean there's nobody around who can begin brawling like I did?
It's very serious now, ever since you soldiers left.
Have any of the old bunch been around here?
No. Except for that guy Turk who comes in now and then.
Turk?
I'm sure you knew him. You remember Albert's friend, the one with the scar on his face.
Yeah, now I remember.
This is a corn gun. So you shoot corn at these hay bales. Looks super fun. Very loud. Hit it! Whoa, that's high! On the hayride, they stopped, and we got corn to throw to the cows.
And you gotta throw the corn.
Oh, they're so cute.
You gotta throw it.
Okay, Zena, stand up here.
Good job. They're gonna eat the corn.
They're so cute.
All right, last one.
Onesie fit my form.
The way they eat is adorable.
He's right by the brown cow. Can you throw it that far?
Baby one.
All right, throw it, kiddo.
Do you see the babies?
It's okay.
The little ones. I'm in a corn maze. I've been in this corn maze for hours and hours. Morgan, where are you? It's giant. It's shaped like lots of Halloween stuff, which is cool. But I can't find my way out. I've been wandering around here and wandering around and going in circles, and I found four checkpoints. And I can't look anymore. More corn and more corn. Wait. Oh, wait, look. I found it. I found the exit. I'm finally out.
Sit down with us. Come on, have a drink.
No, thanks. All by yourself now? Or are you expecting Diana? Directly behind me, there's a guy who's been eyeing you. He's been watching you for a long time.
Thanks, Ursula. Too bad. He's not my type.
Watch your step. Hi. Have you been waiting for me long?
Just a couple of whiskeys.
Ask me for a dance?
Sure, sure.
Hey, Bert. Can I persuade you to come along with us on the expedition?
I'd certainly be a lot happier if you came along. You know the jungle better, too.
It's far more likely to be dangerous for anyone right here than it is out there in the jungle. You better watch your daughter, though. Someone could just run off with her.
Yeah.
Another wristband.
It's a souvenir. Who gave you the bracelet? Boyfriend?
No, my father.
Night. Night, Bert.
Night. Be right back.
Hold it. Gun. All right, men, now do it.
If you hadn't come along, I'd have been in real trouble. I owe you a lot. Thanks.
The pleasure was all mine.
What's going on?
It's just like the good old days.
You were right. It's the men, not the animals, that are the real danger.
Right now, it's men, not animals, that I'm going to settle with.
All right. But, Bert, seriously, won't you please come hunting with us? Listen, when I was away at school, I was always thinking about you. I dreamed I loved you.
Well, don't you?
Oh, maybe I do. Of course.
I'll bet you are. Next time, maybe.
It's so exciting. You know, I can hardly wait to find out if there really is a sacred monkey.
I already told you it's a legend. Just one of many. Anyhow, I think we better stay on the beaten path.
Oh, do you really think there's any danger?
Of course not, but that's beside the point. The truth is, there's no sense in driving all that way just to shoot at a legend.
You're awful, Robert. Shooting ordinary game isn't any fun at all. I mean, everyone loves doing something unusual. Look, a pair of lions.
They didn't even condescend to look at us.
Good hunting down there.
Look at those birds.
Thank you.
unload. They're just cubs. Be careful. They look ferocious.
Aren't they cute?
Yeah, they sure are playful. Forget him anyway. He's not wounded. Hey, your bracelet. Take care, you'll lose it. Let's go. Thank you.
I'm exhausted. Are we going to stop anywhere?
Melinda says there's a campsite just over there.
Behind me here is Phantom Lake in Maguanago, Wisconsin. Now, interestingly, it got its name from a lot of Native American legends from way back. So this whole area in Maguanago, Wisconsin was settled by Native American tribes. And legend has it that there were two tribes here camped out on different banks of Phantom Lake. It's a whole long story about two warriors and the chief of the tribe and his daughter. But anyway, it comes down to every year there is a spirit here that haunts Phantom Lake, and every year it claims, or it would claim, one girl from the tribe as its bride, which is super weird. Okay, it sounds like a sort of normal sacrificing kind of legend, always involves women, but whatever. Anyway, so this is Phantom Lake here, and another interesting fact about it is that there was also a 2006 movie made called The Monster of Phantom Lake about a monster that inhabits this lake and is very protective of its territory, and it was sort of a 1950s style B-movie is what they were aiming for. So it was done in 2006, but in the style of 1950s, set in the 1950s in Wisconsin. Now let's see if we can go get haunted by the Phantom of Phantom Lake. Another kind of cool thing about Phantom Lake, when I was looking into the legend, I found a 1922 newspaper that talked about the legend. So I was actually kind of confused when reading the legend, because according to this legend, there was a tribe and another tribe had moved into the area because they needed more fertile grounds. And a member, a warrior from the other tribe, was interested in the chief's daughter. So he went, talked to the chief, and they got an understanding. And then meanwhile, she had a relationship already going with someone from her tribe. He didn't go through her father, he went through her, and they really liked each other. So she wanted to be with him, but then he disappeared and the guy from the other tribe was blamed for it. And they sent him out to go find the guy. And they said, if you don't come back within 4 days, then you're gonna be in trouble. You gotta bring him back in 4 days. So we came back in 4 days without the guy, but then said, oh, you gotta come to the lake and watch it as the sun sets. And as the sun set, they watched and they saw the warrior. They saw two canoes. One had like two people in it, and the other one had the warrior that they were missing. Now the warrior they were missing leapt onto the other canoe and tackled the guy, and they fell in the water. And then the girl was pulled under by a spirit, and then people believed in the monster. But I don't understand. Like, what I'm confused on is, how would the other guy know this, and why was the guy in the canoe? And the whole thing made like no sense to me, and I was debating even telling the story because it's so confusing and it didn't make any sense. But I was like, you know, maybe somebody else has some context to add to this, or it makes sense to somebody else and just not me. So I figured I would tell that somewhat truncated version, but that's the important stuff I read. And I almost feel like I was missing a whole lot of stuff in there that would have made that whole sequence of events make sense. This lake is actually pretty big. If you can see, there is one part, and then it's kind of blocked off in the middle, but this part over here is also Phantom Lake, more considered Lower Phantom Lake. What I thought was kind of cool driving in here is that there was a YMCA camp right here on Phantom Lake, and the whole thing with the people being pulled into the water and stuff had a very Friday the 13th vibe to it, I thought.
You're a good cook, Malumba.
Thank you, sir.
You know, this is really a great supper.
I guess you must be very hungry tonight. Your appetite's never as good as this at home.
I thought I was going to collapse. I couldn't walk another step today.
You go get a good night's sleep, and you'll be all right tomorrow.
For a beginner, you're not doing too badly. When you get used to it, things will improve. And your aim will improve, too.
Oh, you mean the leopard?
Yep. You frightened him away. The hunter has to stay calm, be cool, be collected.
Sounds like there's trouble over there.
I'll go look. What's the trouble, Malumba?
My men don't want to continue. There's a taboo on the jungle. They say there's a powerful evil spirit. And it follows the sacred monkey.
You can tell them I'll double their pay and be ready tomorrow morning at dawn.
Now, remember this. Liana's life depends on you. Go back to Nairobi immediately. Explain what happened to your father. And say that if he wants his daughter back alive, there's only one way to get her.
I tell you, Bert, when I came out of the tent, one of the gorillas was already carrying Diana away. The other gorilla, the one that hit me, was attacking the rest of the camp. It was, I don't know, human almost. I know you may think this is stupid of me. They behaved as if they had a plan that had all been prearranged.
I don't know, as if they were some kind of robots.
Robots. If you say so. It's hard to believe a story like that.
You know that when gorillas are mad, they go berserk and smash everything. Whereas these two apes stopped when they kidnapped her.
Bert, have you heard the news? You'll have to do something. I don't know who else I can turn to help Diana.
Theodore, I think it's a bit too late.
But if she's still alive, it wouldn't be the first time that gorillas have spared their prey. And you're the only person that can do anything. Isn't that right, Robert? Can't you persuade him?
What's the point? Bert really doesn't want to help. We'll look for Diana ourselves. You haven't got a hope of finding her. I'm not going.
I'd leave the safari myself if I was younger. At least I can pay well. Any figure you name. Come on, how about it?
Bert.
There's something important I didn't tell you. I was afraid you wouldn't believe me.
I saw Turk out there.
Are you sure?
I've never been surer. I saw him after the girl has left. I have no idea where he came from. But when I regained consciousness, he was standing there watching me. I'm convinced that he's behind it. The kidnapping.
I've changed my mind, Theodore. I'll go.
Thanks, Bert. I was sure you wouldn't disappoint us.
I think you mentioned money.
Sure, I never go back on a promise. You know that. You get the other half when Diana's safe.
Start getting ready, Robert.
Good for you, Robert. You did it.
Keep your confidence to yourself.
What's wrong with you?
Whiskey.
Two whiskeys. I'll bet you're on your way to rescue Diana. Listen, Bert. You know, in spite of what I told Theodore, you still mean more to me than he does.
Does that really matter?
Watch your step. You may find that it's actually dangerous to violate ancient taboos. Careful, don't say anything.
I want to talk to you, Ursula. Come on.
Ursula. Thanks for the advice. Swimming. There's something moving. Ah, it's a python. Don't kill it.
Monkeys! The sacred monkeys!
Where?
There, in the treetop.
That's a chimpanzee.
I don't mean a chimpanzee.
This is our camp. This is where the gorillas attacked us. It's just the way I left it. Pack the provisions and make a fire. All right, step on it. And take that body down the hill and bury it.
No! No, taboo, taboo! I know such fire.
Don't be stupid. Do like you're told. Understand? Or I'll make you wish you had.
Calm down, Robert. There's no reason to act like that. You've been getting worse and worse ever since we left the boat. What's wrong with you, kid? I'm beginning to get worried about you. Take it easy now.
I'm sorry, Bert, but this is where Diana was kidnapped. Bert?
Yeah?
Oh, nothing.
Don't go too far. We'll start searching tomorrow.
Camp here, but don't light any fire.
Yes, master.
Where are you going? I'm here.
I kept my promise.
You're a clever boy.
Now it's your turn. Where's Diana?
You worried about your sister. I told you, the minute I'm able to get my hands on Bert, you can have her. The word of a gentleman, you see.
I persuaded Bert to come with me, and now he's here, and I want to see Diana.
Calm down. I'll tell you when it's the right moment.
Careful, Turk. I was forced to betray an old friend of mine, you rat.
Is that scum your friend?
Be careful. You don't try to push me too far, Turk. There isn't anything I'd like better than to kill you, and the only reason I don't is because of Diana.
It's lucky for you, Robert, that I really want Bert. Or this kind of behavior could get you into serious trouble.
All right. I want to know where Diana is.
I already said you'll see your sister when I'm ready. But first, I have to get Bert. And that won't be any too easy.
You remember. You promised not to kill him. As a gentleman, you even gave me your word on it.
Don't worry. I'll keep my end of the bargain. And as long as I have Diana, you'll do anything I want.
Hey guys, it's Celeste here, and I am in Maquoneka, Wisconsin, at what Google said is the Heaven City Restaurant. However, upon going inside, I realized that it has been closed for about 5 years, and they now run estate sales out here. So that's cool. I was looking for something to eat. But anyway, what's interesting about this place is it is reported to be haunted. The origins of the haunting say that it is haunted because the site was a Native American burial ground where this restaurant was built, and that there were sightings of apparitions at times, and that things would randomly fall off and break, like glasses would fall off counters and break when there was nobody around. So I talked to the person that's been here for a few years running things. She says she's never encountered anything. But that doesn't mean there's not something here. I just thought it was a fun place to stop by. Now, if you look here, there is a sign here for Heaven City. So the land was a favorite place for the Native Americans. The first white settler owner, Gaius Munger, noted for maple syrup production. Other owners, Abraham Perkins, sheep raiser, Wisconsin Central RR promoter, let's see, blah, 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 all these people, pony raiser, tobaccoist, built a large Spanish-style home, and there was a gambler. And in 1932, Chicago street preacher A.J. Moore purchased the site for commune prototype Heaven City. So the commune failed, and the buildings were added in early 1940s to convert it to a commercial hotel and resort. There were lavish accommodations, and meals attracted underworld types for getaway weekends. After many business problems, there have been a series of owners. And this was last revised in 1999, this sign. So that's a little bit of info about Heaven City. I'm interested in this commune, which makes sense on the name now.
Honey. When the jungle is silent, spirit of death is near. It's a warning for the unlucky.
We'll soon see if there are any spirits around here.
With Interpol.
And?
Well, I'm investigating your robbery.
I've no idea what you're talking about.
Albert Muller, I suppose you don't know who he is. I'm not interested in you at all. It's him that I'm really looking for.
You're wasting your time. I haven't seen Albert for a year now.
Yeah, I know you haven't seen him since the payroll robbery. When he tried to murder you. While you were in the hospital, you were delirious for weeks. From what you said, we were able to reconstruct the crime. We only let you go so that you could lead us to Albert Muller. My principal objective is to find out exactly what that maniac is doing.
What do you mean?
We're convinced that Albert Muller is experimenting on conditioned brain reflexes in certain kinds of animals. The results could be disastrous.
He always thought of himself as a genius. But what do I get out of it? I help you.
A bargain. And we might arrange a reward.
And how am I going to settle my score with Albert?
That's up to you. I'm not going to try to save him.
I think we'll get along all right, Forrester.
Bert! Bert, help me.
Robert.
Forgive me, Bert. I'm sorry.
What happened?
It was the apes.
This wasn't part of the plan, was it, Robert?
You mean you knew you were tricked all along?
Yeah, I suspected something. Who put you up to it? Diana?
No, she doesn't know anything of this. Help her, Bert. Albert's got a prisoner somewhere. Only watch out for that man. He's crazy. Some kind of idea to get rich and famous, and even my father put money into it. That's why...
What happened?
The plane went wrong.
What happened to Bert?
He was captured by a tribe of Sakabi. But maybe it's not too late to save him yet.
How can you say a thing like that? Are you crazy? I don't want them against me.
I had everything planned to the letter. It was all so perfect.
Perfect.
Your guerrillas got the other man instead of Bert. It was the guerrillas that ruined the plan.
What went wrong? What? What?
What next?
I don't know, but let's get moving. We've got work to do.
Savages. They expect us to run for our lives. Let's go!
Tonight, I've had a super long day, but I'm here and I'm excited to be here. And I'm really excited about the story I get to tell tonight. So, I recently took a trip to Mukwonago, Wisconsin, and in doing so, I found out about a supposedly haunted restaurant called Heaven City that was reported to be haunted by the spirits of as a result of being established on the grounds of an old Native American burial site, which is a very common trope in movies. So I was interested. I was really excited to check it out. So imagine my disappointment when I learned that the restaurant had actually been closed for a few years and Google was a filthy liar. They said it was open. My relationship with Google may never recover. However, it did lead me to an interesting piece of information, which is that the restaurant name, Heaven City, was based on a commune that had been established at that location. And to be honest, it totally looked like the place where a commune would sit. There was a semicircle of buildings, including a bar, the former restaurant, what looked like some residences, and another small shop. Oh, and an informational sign about the origins of Heaven City. I knew I needed to look more into this commune, and I'm really not sorry that I did, because it's an interesting story and one that I'm looking forward to share with you. The story goes way back and begins in Illinois, in McHenry County, to be exact. Now, this commune was started as a kind of a cult, and we all know that cults fascinate me. But this seems to have been a fairly benign cult in general when it started. So it started, there didn't seem to be many of the more insidious elements that are pervasive in most stories about cults. It was kind of described as a love cult by the Chicago Tribune in 1922. So this was a long time ago, about 100 years ago. The group was led by a man named Dr. Albert J. Moore. Albert Moore was born in Wales in 1881 and moved to the U.S. in 1902. He first lived in Ohio, but later moved to New York State and opened a practice as a healer and a member of the Christian Science faith. So it doesn't seem like he actually had any specific medical training, but he considered himself a Christian Science healer. He gave himself the title of doctor through this practice, although I couldn't find any evidence that he had any kind of medical degree at all. At some point, Albert got married, and during the 1910s, he moved with his wife, Edith, and their two young sons to a place called River Forest in Illinois. River Forest is a village that is adjacent to Chicago, and it was here, in Chicago, that Moore opened up what he called the Life Institute Temple on East Ontario Street. My hair keeps getting in my face. Through this temple, Moore told the people who attended that he could heal people from their physical ailments through a combination of prayer and positive living. He was apparently not a very humble man, as some accounts say that he would, on occasion, boast about how there were some cases in which he could raise the dead just using his prayers. These claims seem to be a bit suspicious to me, and in fact, Moore was accused of preying on older widowed women and was actually convicted of fraud in 1922. However, he appealed this conviction and it was eventually overturned. I don't know why it was overturned, actually, because it sounds like he was using his position as a healer to tell people, like, if they're saying older widowed women, that maybe he was fooling these women into thinking that he might be able to resurrect their dead husbands or loved ones or connect with them somehow, and that's really sad. Now, here's where the story starts to get a little more interesting and full of intrigue. Sometime in early 1922, so around the time when he was dealing with the fraud accusations, football player William W. Talcott loudly proclaimed in a public statement that Moore had stolen the affections of his wife, Shirley. The Chicago papers described Moore as being, and I quote, a love master with hypnotic eyes, and he was accused of having an affair with Talcott's wife. I tried to find a picture of Moore. I don't think I was successful, but I'm really curious as to see what this love master with hypnotic eyes looked like. Anyway, the football player Talcott then tried to get his wife and her affections back. However, she rebuffed him. She was like, no, thanks, I'm done. I want to be with Moore. And as a result, Talcott tragically took his own life by filling his pockets with stones and jumping into Lake Michigan. That's really unfortunate because I always think heartache is temporary and death is permanent. However, he died on August 24th, 1922, at the age of 49. When reporting about the event, the Chicago Tribune referred to it as a 1922 Chicago sensation. And I think this really got the eyes of people on Moore and what he was doing, and it caught people's attention. After this event, Shirley Talcott was still enamored with Moore and stayed loyal to him. Moore was not found to have any guilt in George Talcott's death, and Moore's wife didn't seem to mind that Shirley was hanging around with her husband, so they carried on like this. And then Moore started gaining more followers through his temple, and by 1923, he decided to relocate the group to a farm on Heartland Road, where he would then move his wife, children, and some of his followers. He called the farm Heaven City, and the group members would all call him Father. Well, maybe not so noteworthy today, it was at the time remarked by a reporter from the Harvard Herald who visited the farm that, and this is a quote from the newspaper, women and girls dress much like men and boys. They all have shorn locks. So apparently all the women and girls had short hair, which, you know, personal choice to me and not very noteworthy today. But I think back then, maybe, in that era, women often had very short hair. So I'm not sure why this was so noteworthy. Maybe it was the style in which they wore it. Maybe it was the fact that all of them did, or their manner of dress along with that. But something to the newspaper seemed noteworthy about it. The farm itself was sitting on 130 acres, making this an ideal compound for the commune. Moore wanted to move his followers here because he predicted that there would be a series of cataclysmic events, which included the financial panic in 1923, a labor strike in 1924, and a world war in 1926. Moore really laid down the law in this compound, enforcing really strict codes of behavior and dress. Some of these rules included a ban on owning private property, which is really standard stuff as far as cults are concerned. In most cults that I've read about, you either have to sell your possessions and give your money to the cult, or you turn over your money and control of it to the cult and all your possessions. So he also had a ban on wearing jewelry. However, one thing that was not regulated at all was intimate adult relations. The policy on these was quite liberal. And this leads to some of the more salacious details of this commune story.
Hey!
Oh. Make yourself at home.
Well, I hope I'm not bothering you, sweetie. I see I got here just in time. So, you've decided to skip out, right?
I'm fed up with you, Theodore. This time you're pushing me just a little too far.
Yeah, what's the matter? You're afraid something will happen to your darling Bert?
Shut up, Buster. Bert doesn't count.
I saw you whispering together. If you two are planning some kind of make a patsy out of Theodore, you might as well forget it.
It's not him I told you. I'm simply bored with this dirty, rotten life. For years you promised to take me away from this hellhole. Paris, London, Rome. Well, I've decided I can't wait. I'm going to get out on my own.
So you think all you have to do is pack your bag and go, is that it? But everything you have is mine! You didn't really think I'd let you get away.
Let go of me. You're hurting me. Let me go.
You'd like me to let you go, wouldn't you? I've kept you for years, and I'll keep you a lot longer. As for Bert, he won't be around to bother us anymore. You hear? You can count on it.
If you move, you'll be sorry. You'll get exactly what you deserve, a bullet in your gut. You're revolting to me. I just can't bear to have you touch me. You make me sick, you
big... Calm down, Ursula. You know it's only because I love you I'm jealous.
Don't move, Theodore. I'll shoot if you make a move.
Wait. Remember, we were in love at one time, huh? And besides, now with this invention of Albert's, which I helped him to finance, we're going to be rich. It won't be long now, Ursula. Ursula, my darling. It just doesn't make sense, but I'm crazy in love with you.
That's more like it, woman. You and I, we're gonna have a talk. Don't worry, I won't hurt you. Are you the sacred monkey? What's your name? I'm Bert. You? You don't know how to talk, or do you? It doesn't matter. I'll call you Eve. But that bracelet, Diana's, where'd you find it? Where did you find this? Don't you understand me? Won't you try to tell me where? That's useless. Take me to Diana. The one who was taken, I can understand, by the gorilla, Lumba. Diana. Where's she gone to? The living proof of all my theories. Just like a robot, he always obeys.
Come on.
This brain is the nerve center that controls all the apes. So you see, I've inserted radios in their skulls to receive impulses from that transmitter over there. Their will ceases. It puts them at my command. This brain cell is responsible. They won't harm you unless I want it. They're my pets. I've managed to eliminate their savage ways. Now you have to learn to obey me like them. If you resist, I'm going to be severe with you. Or I can lock you in that cell over there for the experiments I perform on women. It's up to you to decide.
No! No! Someday you'll pay for all this! Oh. Call him off!
You're all paid! I can take control of all humanity with this invention. I'll be rich and powerful. All of you will do as I say!
You must be out of your mind.
Ah, we have visitors. Go and have a look, Turk. If it's who I think it is, get him. Go on. Come on. I'll deal with you later. Inside.
It brings us to one of Moore's followers who was named George Schofield, and he was a 50-year-old man who had left his wife in Oklahoma City to join up with the group. So abandons his wife and joins a love cult at 50 years old. It seems that the local newspapers were always interested in the doings of this group, as the June 13, 1925 edition of the Harvard Herald referred to George as a frisky Lothario. Anyway, this Lothario became interested in another cult member who was a 15-year-old runaway named Nina Roundtree. Gross. So gross. Even though the newspaper at the time reported that this girl was much older in appearance than her 15 years, the fact that she was 15 and that's completely inappropriate and disgusting. Like, I don't care how old she looked or what was going on with her. There is no situation in which a 50-year-old man has any business being interested in a 15-year-old girl. But I won't get on my soapbox about this. I don't even want to say the way the newspapers describe this teenager because it's gross and it makes me feel icky. Anyway, George was so obsessed with Nina that he decided to challenge a much younger man who was part of the commune to a boxing match to prove himself to Nina. Not really sure what he was trying... My cat's out there. Anyway, I don't know what he was really trying to prove with this, like what good he thought it would do, but he decided the best way to win her affections or prove himself to her was to box another member. However, it didn't really turn out the way that George wanted to, and in the end, he lost. Badly. In fact, he lost so badly that Nina jumped into the ring herself and taunted him, saying that even she could beat him in a boxing match. So what I gather from this, and this is just my personal speculation, I gather that she really had no interest in George and that she never really entertained him or had interest in him at all. Because, you know, suddenly she's in there, she's watching the boxing match, but she's the first one to jump in. And instead of being there for him when he loses, she's making fun of him, she's taunting him, she's kind of having fun with the idea that he would try to do this and then it would turn out so badly for him. So while she's jumping around, taunting him, she's dancing around George, he was chasing her around the boxing ring when suddenly he fell to the floor and died. The coroner pronounced that George had died of natural causes. However, his abandoned wife refused to take his body when she was informed of his death. She's like, you know what? He left me. I want nothing to do with him. I don't want to deal with his body. Like, I don't think she wanted the expense of it, even though legally, you know, they were married, so she might have had a legal responsibility, but she refused it. She was like, I don't want anything to do with this dude. Take his body. I don't want it. There are no records or proof of it, and there is no visible tombstone with his name on it, but it is commonly believed that he was buried in Mount Auburn Cemetery in Harvard, Illinois. After all the publicity from this event, the Harvard Herald began to openly criticize what they dubbed the Love Colony, and also a nearby roadhouse called Bubbling Over, which was about a mile from the commune. And this was frequented by members of the commune to the point where they became associated with each other. Now, the roadhouse openly sold alcohol at the time of Prohibition and was also home to what was called by the newspaper, again, this newspaper really likes to write about this stuff, newspaper called them loose women from Elgin, and Elgin is another town in Illinois. They were thought to be representative of the low level of morality that was found in the county. However, Heaven City at the farm continued to function in the area, and in the 1930s, the federal census listed that there were 27 people who were living at what was termed the Heaven City School. This number included Shirley Talcott and her children, so Shirley was still with Moore after all this time. We don't know what prompted the move. However, the entire colony left McHenry County in 1934 and moved to Mequonago, Wisconsin, where I got to visit the site. Moore bought over 400 acres and moved the entire group of his disciples to this location. The cult members took what had been a resort area and turned it into a building that had 16 motel rooms and 11 apartments. Moore decided that he wanted to find a way around paying taxes, so he had the idea to open up a Montessori-style school for his children and the children of his disciples. Moore's wife Edith and Shirley Talcott were there with him, along with 17 other people during this move. Some of the people who were there, besides Moore, Edith, and Shirley, were some unmarried twin sisters named Grace and Maud Spangler, who were 57 at the time. Shirley herself was also 57 when the tribe moved to Mequonago. There were also two teenagers in the 1940 federal census who were listed as students, but that's all the information that I could find about the people who were living in Heaven City at the time in Mequonago. To end the saga of the Heaven City commune, Albert Moore died at the compound on May 11th of 1963, and Edith Moore died at the compound sometime around July of 1964. So there's a space of about 30 years, 29 years since Albert died, and 30 years since Edith died, where they moved to Mequonago and nothing really of note seemed to have happened. There was no newspaper articles I could find, no information about this cult, no weird activities. Maybe they chilled out in their older age. Maybe they found a good place for them. Maybe the town left them alone. They left the town alone. Maybe the newspapers didn't really care anymore. But for whatever reason, their time in Mequonago seems to have been pretty quiet. So after Edith died, Shirley Talcott tried to keep the people in the colony together and operating as a business, but she really struggled to keep everyone together. So it kind of seemed like at this point it was no longer a love cult because their father had died and the people keeping them together. And so Shirley decided that she was going to try to keep it as a business. However, with the place slowly falling into disrepair and decay, Shirley tried to keep a restaurant open at the site, and she died there in December of 1982. Grace Spangler died in 1968. One of the twins and her twin Maud died in 1973. So it seems like a lot of people actually managed to die at the site of this commune building. Like, they stayed there until they died. The commune buildings are still around today and have been repurposed into other things. And there ends the story of the Mukwonago commune known as Heaven City. I kind of love that I started out going there for one thing, one story, a ghost story, and ended up finding something completely different, a whole different story. So let me know what you think of the Heaven City Mukwonago cult, and have a good night.
Diana?
Mm-hmm.
Well, Bert, welcome. I've been waiting for you. I was afraid you might not be able to find me. That's why I made Theodore organize the rescue party. For a while, I thought the Sakavis would spoil my plans, but you were too smart for them. You're an excellent specimen of the human race. Strong, clever, brave. That's why I've chosen you for my first experiment on a human being. You'll have the honor of being the first man to become my slave. Come on. Come on, I'm waiting. I'm sure you're not afraid.
Keep bumping into you everywhere I go. It must be fate.
Bring him here, Turk! Kill him, you fool!
I'm gonna kill you.
Sacred monkey, no less, captured by one of her subjects. Come out. Look, the ape will obey you. Now they only take orders from me. You see? You'll find out they won't listen to you anymore. Soon you too will obey when I command. Malik! Bert, I see you got away from Turk. Listen, Bert. You'll have to do what I tell you to do for once. Diane and the girl are my prisoners. Their life depends on you. You wouldn't want their death to be on your conscience, would you, Bert? You better hurry if you expect to see them alive. If you don't get here in 10 minutes, I'll turn them over to the gorillas, and there won't be much left for you. Do you hear, Bert? The gorillas are getting excited. They're just waiting for the word. You better give yourself up. I'll wait for 10 minutes. Then I'll release them. Come on. Why resist? You can't escape. I'm looking forward to seeing you again, Bert. My old comrade in arms. You see, Diana, your Bert doesn't stand a chance. He'll be here soon. Calm down, my pets. There's no hurry.
Albert, where's my daughter?
Father! Father! Help, Father! Get me out of here!
Unlock that cell!
Listen.
Or I'll shoot you down like a dog.
Nothing's happened to her at all.
Because I got here too fast, Albert. As soon as I saw that those gorillas of yours had killed Robert, I realized the truth. What do you take me for, jackass?
It was a mistake.
Oh, my head.
You're just stalling for time.
The gorillas were sent to get Bert. I swear, I really only wanted Bert.
I get the impression you'd like to get your hands on Diana. You've got no business touching her. Now get moving, Albert. Open that cell. Go on. Go on! Hurry up. Ursula, look after Diana.
Careful, Theodore.
We're going to settle a few things.
Don't forget, Bert is still around. Wait.
You can't fool me, Albert. I don't care about Bert anymore, see? I went along with your plan because I wanted him out of the way. I thought I could trust you. I even gave you money for all those crazy experiments. That was a mistake.
I'll give it back, all right.
But you can't give me back my son. You murdered Robert. And you almost killed Diana. But you're not going to kill anybody else. You're through.
Now,
No, I'm not.
Don't move.
You see, I still had one more card to play.
Surprise, Theodore. I wasn't going to escape with Bert, but with him. Albert promised to take me away from this horrible country. That's why I was packing this morning. You're gonna die, understand? For all the years of putting up with you.
Father! 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 Oh. You killed him!
I hate you! I hate you! It's all your fault that I could never get away. It's always been your fault, you little fool, and now it's your turn. Well, because Theodore spent his money on luxuries for you and your brother instead of thinking just about me.
I've been hunting the sacred monkey for a year, and I don't intend to lose her now. When I want something, I take it and I keep it forever.
Not this time, Albert. This time you've finally lost the game.
You're really punctual, Bert. You're never late for an appointment. You arrive within the 10 minutes. Fast work, Bert. But I haven't lost the game yet, as you'll soon find out. Look out, Bert.
What do you mean?
Oh, the electronic brain! Shoot the light on the pen!
All right! Hold it!
Bert, get shoot the gun. Light!
They're yours, Eva.
Nahana! Nahana!
Stop! 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 I'm your master! I'm your master! No.
Mind if I give her your bracelet?
No, of course not. It'll bring her good luck.
So long, Eva.
Goodbye, Eva.
Hello, hello, I'm Beck. I hope you really enjoyed this movie. I know I did. And, well, this neighborhood is not as friendly as I thought it was, but that's okay. I also hope you enjoyed my adventures and the McGuanago monster in the lake. I really like that legend. And also the weird commune cult I stumbled upon. Shut up, birds! I'm always tweeting birds out here. You would think they'd stop, but they don't. Anyway, so I wanted to say thank you so much for joining us for this movie. It's been really fun to show. Worth all the editing to cut out all the not safe for TV parts. But I don't know. It's just a fun, weird movie. It's got a lot of 60s vibe to it, we'll say. So I enjoy that about the movie. And I couldn't really find too much trivia on it, except that, you know, it has absolutely nothing to do with King Kong. It does have to do with gorillas, so I guess that's our link. And there's also no island. But other than those things, Kong Island is a 100% accurate title for this movie. Yeah, I think it's weird too. But I think it gets attention, and it would draw people in, and then people say it's about gorillas. It's not too far off, so let's roll with that. Anyway, by the way, that corn maze, no kidding, like, I thought Morgan would have looked for me by the time I got out, but she didn't. In fact, she was really busy and, you know, decorating our house with new burn marks and, you know, some stuff was destroyed. I don't know if she was really decorating so much as messing with, but we're going to go with decorating because I'm an optimist. Anyway, she was so caught up in that she didn't even realize that I was gone for that long, stuck in a corn maze, eating corn. That's all I had to eat, corn and a granola bar. But, you know, the corn stalks, they do collect dew in the morning, so that is a fun fact if you're stuck in a cornfield. Anyway, thanks for joining us tonight. We hope to see you next time, and as always, we will hex you soon.